Jesus Christ said, I have come to fulfill what was written in the law, the prophets, and the Psalms. So Jesus came, and then it is stated about him in Hebrews, especially from chapter 2 right through chapter 10. He came to fulfill, to finish, to take away, to end, to annul the law. Called the first. He said, so that he can bring in or establish the new, which is the New Testament. So in Hebrews chapter 8, the last two verses, and then in Hebrews chapter 9, and then in Hebrews chapter 10, from verses about 4 right through verse 14, it says, Jesus totally annulled the law, the previous order, and he totally inaugurated and established the new, which is the testament that he died to leave us. So we have a total new order with a total new high priest, with a total new way of worship, with a total new way of blessings. So we are not in the blessings of Moses. We are in the blessings of Abraham. So people preach the blessings of Abraham and then they read out of Deuteronomy 28. That's an error. Deuteronomy 28, Abraham is not mentioned. The law is mentioned. If you will abide in this whole law and do all that I command you this day, you shall be blessed. Deuteronomy 28. That's the law. But when God spoke to Abraham, he said, Abraham, in blessing I will bless you. In multiplying I will multiply you. Full stop. If anybody bless you, they'll be blessed too. If anybody curse you, they'll be cursed. But you, Abraham, you don't have to do to get. I just bless you. Abraham believed and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So Abraham got righteousness because he believed that God said, you are blessed. Now Galatians 3:29 says, if we now belong to Christ, then we are heirs according to the promise of Abraham. So we receive the blessings of Abraham, not the blessings of Moses. The blessings of Deuteronomy 28 is conditional. You've got to stick to the law to get blessed. In Jesus Christ, we received a testament. A testator died and he left us a will. He came out of the tomb and became the lawyer, the attorney, the advocate of his own testament. And he went to God the Father, the righteous judge, as the advocate to make sure that we're going to get our testament. So for a testament, you don't do anything. You just wait for the person with the goods to die and make sure that your name is on the will. So when Jesus Christ died, imagine whose name was written on the will. Your name and my name was on the will. And so we don't do anything. We just go to the judge, God the Father. Speak to the advocate, the Lord Jesus Christ, and get the agent involved, the Holy Spirit, and get the goods for nothing. Just by believing. Abraham believed and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So let's pick the story up in verse 4 of Romans chapter 10. For Christ is the end of the law. So if you've been here Easter weekend, and if you were not here, get the CDs, DVDs or tapes and listen. Christ is the end of the law, the limit at which it ceases to be. For the law leads up to him, who is the fulfillment of its types. And in him, the purpose which it was designed to accomplish is fulfilled. Amen. That is the purpose of the law is fulfilled in him, that is Christ, as the means of righteousness for everyone who trusts him and adheres to and relies on him. It's more or less Abraham stuff the same. Abraham, you are blessed. I believe, so go. So Jesus came, said, you are blessed, we believe, he says, go. You are now righteous, you are now sanctified, you are now justified, you are now holy. I mean, Wednesday night was one of the awesome messages that I ever preached in all my life. You are holy. But we struggle to get holy. That's why we never get holy. Because the minute you struggle to get, you still stick to the law. But the minute you believe, you get what you believe for. You see, so if we believe what Christ did, holiness will be our portion. But if we struggle to get holy, we will always be unholy because we will always fall for the law. Because the law can't make you holy. Verse 5, for Moses writes that the man who can practice the righteousness, which is based on the law, shall live by it. But the righteousness based on faith, imputed by God and bringing a right relationship with Him, says, the righteousness based on faith says, the righteousness based on faith says, comma, do not say it. Okay, so tonight, let's give the message a topic that I think I've just done it twice so far in my life, so this will be the third time that I've given a message a title. Now you can preach your own message, and I guarantee you by prophetic feeling that you will not be right. You can imagine now what I'm going to preach and you're not going to get it. If somebody got it, there's a block that you can come make your right mark in. If I was right, I put the wrong mark in there. I'm going to touch on something tonight that I trust will be a blessing to you. This is only scraping the surface of the fight of faith. You can preach 10,000 other sermons, but the one you will hear tonight is going to explode on the inside of you and say, is this why I must fight the fight of faith? Is this actually what God means by fighting the fight of faith? So Romans comes and says, the righteousness which is of faith says, on the other side of the line, so there's two parts to this coin. The one is say, the one is do not say. So there's times and things and stuff that you need to say if you want to live and fight the good fight of faith. But if you want to fight this good fight of faith, there's stuff that you must not say. So you can say all the right stuff, but if you say the other side stuff too, you're not fighting the fight of faith. To fight means I stand for something. I don't give in. So many Christians says all the right stuff. Their confession has no lack, but they also say the other side too. Okay, so let's go on to verse 6. Do not say, verse 7, verse 8. You know, don't go to heaven. Who shall go to heaven, bring Christ down? Who shall go to heaven, bring Him up again? Verse 8. But what does it say? The word, God's message in Christ, is near you, on your lips and in your heart. We all know this, but wait a minute till we get to what we're going to say tonight. That is the word of faith which we preach. Because if you acknowledge and confess, now the word confess actually means acknowledge. If you go to the dictionary, the word confess means to acknowledge. Confess and acknowledge with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and in your heart believe that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Now that word saved, we know, doesn't mean go to heaven. It means deliverance from destruction, protected from evil and harm, healed, perfected, matured, helped in every situation. It's a Greek word, sozo, which is an all-encompassing word for bringing you the best. So, if I confess, so what does it say? The word, now remember the fight of faith. The word of faith says, if we confess with our mouth, Jesus is Lord, we shall be saved. Now, the word Lord in the Greek is the word kurios, not the one that you buy on the waves. It means maximum and total authority. So if I confess that Jesus Christ has total authority, I shall be delivered, helped, healed, blessed, protected, wherever I go and in whatever circumstance I am. If I confess, this is the word of faith. It has a confession with it. Now, till now, we all know everything. I see that and I acknowledge that. Verse 10, for the heart a person believes, and so is justified. And with the mouth, he confesses openly and speak out freely his faith and confirms his salvation. Now, take it and hear something. This is actually a revelation coming through. It's not what you've heard before. I want to take that word of confess and put it in the context, and we're going to discuss it tonight. If I confess and keep on confessing, okay, with my heart the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and speak out freely and confess. So I confess Jesus is Lord, and I confess the word of faith. So if I confess that and that, and I keep on confessing that, I will confirm my healing, my salvation, my deliverance, my protection, my health, my protection, my healing, my blessings, my deliverance, my protection, my health, my salvation, my health, my healing, my protection. I will confirm if I take the word of faith and I say, and I do not say. We'll come to that in a minute. I will confirm with the fact that Jesus Christ is total ruler and supreme authority over everything. So wherever I am, He is in complete control. He is Lord. So He has maximum authority no matter where I am and what I do. If I confess that and keep on confessing that that is my faith, I will confirm that I am all the time saved. That means nothing will ever hurt me, harm me. I will not sit with a lot of stuff and nonsense in my life, because no evil will come near my dwelling place. I shall not be hurt. I shall not be harmed. Angels will guard over me. I will be under the wings of the protection of the Almighty God. Psalm 91, dwell in the secret place of the Most High. So that is the place we're supposed to be. Right? Verse 11. The scripture says, no man who believes in Him will be put to shame or disappointed. So, if I keep on confessing and say the right stuff and never say the other stuff, I will not be put to shame, because the Lord Jesus Christ, who is now an absolute authority, will make sure that there will be confirmation of my confession. Okay? Verse 16, talking about Israel. But they have not all heeded the gospel. For Isaiah says, who has believed our report? Who had faith in what they heard from us? So faith comes by hearing what is told. And what is heard comes by the preaching. Now we know the preaching is the preaching of faith. Verse 8. Right. But I ask, have they not heard? Indeed, they have heard. Okay? Just look at me. The word of faith is something you say after you've heard it. But when you say it, there's some things that you do not say. And if you keep on confessing and keep on confessing and keep on confessing. And one of your confessions is that Jesus is in supreme authority, total rulership. He is the maximum authority in your life. You will not be put to shame, because wherever you go, it'll be confirmed that you are saved. Confirmed that you are saved. Confirmed that you are saved. Have you ever seen? Confirmed. Yeah. Confirmed that you are saved. Now, saved is not from hell to heaven. Saved here again is total health, total prosperity, total deliverance, total protection from whatever can come your way. So there is a better place in Christ for us to live in. Okay? Is that okay? So go to 1 Timothy and chapter 6. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold of the eternal life to which you were summoned. Does anybody know what the word summon means? Have you ever received one? Okay. Don't worry. Just look holy. And for which you confessed the good confession of faith before many witnesses. Now he says to fight, he says it's a good fight. Oh, that was a good fight, man. The good fight. The good fight of faith. Okay? Now he says how you fight the good fight. He says, lay hold. So to fight this good fight, I've got to lay hold on something. Now keep your finger in there and quickly go to what we did last Saturday night, I think, Philippians 3. Was it last Saturday? Or we Philippians. I wanted to quote it, but just let's read it. Verse 12. Now remember, our jumping off place is the old and the new. Christ came to fulfill the old, to establish the new. Listen. Not, verse 12, not that I have attained this ideal. Now listen, there's a confirmation. There's something that we just read. You are summoned to have. Let's take the word summons and take it a bit further after the summons. You are arrested by Christ to be something and to get something. And to get this, you got to fight the good fight of faith. Because you are summoned and arrested in Christ to be more and have more than what you ever saw in all your life. So Paul says, not that I have attained this ideal or have already been made perfect, but I press on to lay hold and make it my own. That for which Christ Jesus has laid hold on me and made me his own. Verse 14. So I press towards this goal to win the prize of what? That high calling. I've been laid hold of. Okay? By Christ. I've been arrested and summoned to be. What? What is this fight of faith that I'm going to fight? Is it a wrestling match? Is it an extreme sport thing? Is it going to press me to the limits? Or is it something that I got to believe, and wow, it's on my account. Abraham believed and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So there's something that Paul, I'm going to lay hold of what Christ has laid hold of me to be something that which is such a high calling, a heavenly calling, an upward calling. It means it's not of this earth, it's higher, but it's on this earth, but it's not of this earth, right? 1 Timothy chapter 6. So fight the good fight of faith. lay hold of the eternal life to which you were summoned and you confessed the good confession of faith before many witnesses in the presence of God. I hope you're going to take the rest, who preserves alive all living things. There's immortality just written in there for anybody. And of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. I charge you. Amen. You are summoned. Amen. Now I'm going to charge you. Amen. To lay hold on a calling in Christ Jesus. It's not only a good fight, it's a good confession. He says, so keep on doing this good confession. You did it before many witnesses. He says, you know what? This good confession, Christ did it before Pilate. So we were very, very young in the ministry. And Annalise had a Sunday school class in the little church we had in Carltonville. And she taught them about the crucifixion and you know, the court case and everything. And she told them, you know, why don't you each draw a picture of what you saw when I told you the story of the crucifixion? So this one little guy came out, and there was the cross with Jesus with the airplane above it. And she said, there were no airplanes. She, and the guy said, but what about Pontius, the pilot? Huh? That was so good. What about Pontius, the pilot? I mean, where's his airplane? Good everybody says good confession brings a good fight of faith, which will bring me to my summons, for which I've been charged, for which I've been laid hold of. And I'm going to lay hold of it, and I'm going to get what I've been laid hold of in Christ Jesus. What is it? What is the context of this thing? Verse 20. Oh, Timothy, I love you, Tim. Huh? I love you, Timothy. I love you, Tim. Timothy, guard and keep the deposit entrusted to you. Turn away, listen, church, from the irreverent babble, godless chatter, with the vain and empty and worldly phrases and subtleties or subtitles and the contradictions in what is falsely called knowledge and spiritual illumination. For by making such profession, which is the exact same word as confession, some have erred, missed the mark as regards the faith. Grace be to you, so be it. Now, say is confess. It's the same word as profess. You go to your dictionary or go to Greek or English dictionary. Confession, profession means to acknowledge or to say. And then it says in brackets, to keep on saying. So confession, profession is I say something that I acknowledge and I keep on saying what I acknowledge. Right? So if I keep on doing this good confession, keep on fighting this good fight of faith, and lay hold of what Christ has laid hold of me, I'm going to get something out of this whole deal. Don't say irreverent babble, godless chatter, vain and empty worldly phrases, subtleties, it means it comes in subtle, contradictions in what is falsely called knowledge and spiritual illumination. Now Paul says to Timothy, don't be busy with stuff that seems right, babblings, vain stuff, subtleties, stuff that will be so subtle and it'll just divide your attention. He says, don't say it. He says, that confession robs you of your confession of faith. That's why James chapter 3 says, if anybody doesn't stumble in his words, he will be a perfect man. See, if I keep on confessing the right stuff, it'll eventually bring me to perfection. But you know, we confess the right stuff and then we come behind and said, how is it? And just to get your sympathy, I'll just confess the wrong stuff. Hoping to get your sympathy, and what I'm getting is I lose faith. I just got knocked out again or down. Paul said, I've been knocked down, but not out. So, what's your confession of faith? I'm saved. Saved. Saved from what? Oh, from harm, destruction, evil, accident, sickness, death. Well, you don't look saved to me, but I am. For Jesus is my Lord. I confess Jesus is my Lord. So we help each other to break down our confession of faith. Now, honestly, just tell me, I'm your friend. Honestly, how are you? Oh, well, to be honest. Be honest. You know, to be honest. So we help each other to break down each other's faith. Because if we keep and lay hold of the good confession, what does he say? We will be saved. And we will confirm our salvation. So Proverbs 18:21, the old scripture that we all know. Death and life are both in the power of your tongue. And he that uses it, he doesn't say what, uses your tongue, shall eat the fruit of your tongue, either death or life. So keep the good confession. Fight the good fight. Say the right stuff. Thank you. Verse 10. Oh, dear Father, by your Spirit, help us now. For it was an act worthy of God and fitting to the divine nature that he, for whose sake and by whom all things have their existence, Jesus Christ, John chapter 1, in bringing many sons into glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect, should bring to maturity the human experience necessary to be perfectly equipped for his office as high priest through suffering. For both he who sanctifies, who makes men holy, and those who are sanctified, all have one Father. For this reason, he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Amen. 14. Since therefore these children share in flesh and blood, he himself in a similar manner partook of the same nature, that by going through death he might bring to naught and make of no effect him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So where's your devil? And also that he might deliver and completely set free all those who through the haunting fear of death were held in bondage through a whole course of their lives. Verse 17, so it is evident that it was essential that he be made like his brethren in every respect, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest. Verse 5, King James, for unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak, but one in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the Son of Man that thou visitest him, our whole Easter weekend conference. Thou made him a little lower than the angels, crowned him with glory, honor, and set him over the work of your hands to rule. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. Everybody say, all things under his feet. All things subjected to man. Come, let's just touch on it for 1 minute. If all things are subjected to you, it means you are supreme ruler over all things. Let's face the Bible. If all things are subjected to you, then you must be the master of them.
Amen.
Okay? Everything subjected under your feet, it means you are over them, ruling as a king.
Amen.
Over all things. Okay? So it says, what is man that art mindful of him, that you visit him for this one purpose? To crown him with glory.
Amen.
Who wears a crown? A king. So, to crown him with glory. To do what? To rule over the works of your hands. So, God made everything in Genesis. Then he made man, and this is what he said to man. Rule and have dominion and subdue everything on the earth. Fowl that fly in the air, animals that walk on the earth and creep on the face, fish that are in the sea, and everything that you can see, you have authority over it. You rule over it. You subdue it. You are the king of the earth. But we know man messed up. And so the psalm writer writes in Psalm 8, and then he quotes it in Hebrews. What is man that you are mindful of him? What is God's mind about you? God's mind about you is to crown you with glory so that you can have authority and rule over all. If he perfected something, it means nothing more can be done to it. He perfected it. So if a wheel is perfected, they can't do anything more to it. But the wheel is not perfect because they just brought out a wheel now that doesn't work with air. Can't puncture. And you can see through the thing. And gives you a softer ride than a normal tire. So the wheel is still not perfect. Imagine the Stone Age. Imagine since you were young, how many times tires have changed. And they started putting steel wires in, and then they made them tubeless, and you know, and they made them wider and smoother and whatever. You know, he says, if he wanted to bring many sons into the place of glory, the crown, rulership, authority, total dominion, this is how he did it. He perfected it by suffering on the cross. That's why Jesus fulfilled everything written in the law, the prophets, and the psalms, and said, it is finished. People struggling so hard to understand the book of Revelation. Just read through the book and see how many times it's written in the book of Revelation. It is finished. It is done. It is finished. It is done. It is finished. It is done. It's not a futuristic book. It's a book looking back at the crucifixion of Christ.
Amen.
Seals broken. The word was opened. We can now read it. Jesus Christ was made flesh. Everything about him is fulfilled.
Amen.
Remember when Jesus talked to the Pharisees? And they said, we're going to stone you. He said, for which work are you going to stone me? He said, no, we're not stoning you for the works. We're stoning you for your confession. Because you said you are the Son of God. So, doesn't your word say, it's quoting from Psalm 82, doesn't your word say you are God's? Ooh. Now he makes himself God. Let's kill him. He says, you have the devil as your father, man. They said, no, God is your father. He said, no, God's not your father. The devil is your father. If God was your father, you would believe me because Abraham believed me. They said, you are not 30. How did Abraham? He said, man, before Abraham was, I am. They said, wow, what is this man saying? He's trying to say, I have maximum authority. I'm the ruler. Lord, my servant lies sick. Go, he's healed. Lord, my daughter has a demon. Go, he's healed. If you confess Jesus is Lord, you'll be saved. Lord, come and live. Lord, come and touch my... Lord, saved! Okay? Let's go on. Verse 17. So it is evident that he was to become a high priest. For he himself has suffered in being tempted. He is able, listen to this, immediately to run to the cry to assist and relieve those who are being tempted and tested and tried. So then, brethren, so what then? So the context, let's just draw another thing here. So the context there is rule with your crown of glory. As a king. So then, because you're supposed to be a king. But where did it say that, Clovis? Just shake up. Shake yourself. God, let's look intelligent. I wanna get you. So then, because you are supposed to rule, because this is God's thoughts about you. He's mindful that he's gonna crown you, take you to glory, many sons. That's why he's not ashamed to call you brother. So he became like you, so that you can become like him. He came down to earth to lift you up into heaven. He came down and became the Son of Man to lift you up so that you can be the Son of God. He came down and left glory to lift you up to get glory. Come on. He came down and died to lift you up so that you can live. He came down and conquered death so that you can live and live. He came and made a good confession of who he was so that you can stand up and make a good confession of who you are in Christ. So he says, when he came into this world, this is what he said. You didn't desire a sacrifice, but you prepared a body for me. So I'm going to take this body to the cross and I'm going to perfect all those who are sanctified and keep the good confession. So you are perfected. You are justified. You are holy. Get Wednesday safe. You are pure. But why is it that all the other stuff is in? Because of mixture. Is that okay? So then, brethren. But Kubas, what has this got to do with kings? Now, if we read, just go on in Hebrews. I'll just quote it because the time is running so fast. Hebrews 9 says, if the blood of bulls and goats could cleanse the worshipper for a time in the flesh, how much more will the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse our consciences from dead work to serve the living God? But what has this got to do? Well, he's the high priest. What does the high priest do? He works with blood. Okay? So he is a faithful high priest to work with blood. Why blood? So Revelation 1:5 and 5:9 says the following. He has washed us in his blood to make us kings, to rule on this earth. So where did he perfect you? On the cross. What did he do on the cross? Shed his blood. What did the blood do? Made you a king. What does a king do? He rule hell with a crown of glory. He wanted to bring many sons into glory, so he became exactly like them and died so that he can lift them up and make them exactly like him so that they don't have to die. So when he raised Christ from the dead, we were raised together and together seated in heavenly places as a king, a ruler with total dominion and total authority over everything. So why don't we see it? Because our confession. I've already said the dot 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 dash dash dash. Let's just read on. So, brethren, consecrated, set apart for God, who share in the heavenly calling. Come on, Philippians 3. That which I've been laid off by Christ, I laid hold of, I am laying hold of the heavenly calling, the high calling. Thoughtfully and attentively consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest, whom we confessed as ours when we embraced the Christian faith. So we get people to say, just say after me. Father, forgive me my sin, deliver me, wash me in your blood. I now confess Jesus Christ is Lord. So he says, you did it when you embraced the faith. Why don't you now lay hold of it, cling to it, and keep on confessing it? Somebody's going to get it within a while from now. Okay? Verse 14. For we have become fellows with Christ and share in all he has for us. Please. If only we hold our first newborn confidence. An original assured expectation in virtue. We are firm and unshaken to the end. Verse 2, chapter 4. For indeed, we have had the glad tidings proclaimed to us just as truly as they. Remember Romans 10? Did they not all hear the gospel? Why did it not benefit him? Benefit them? Come. It didn't benefit them? Says the good news of deliverance from bondage came to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them because it was not mixed with faith. So what does faith do? It says, and he doesn't say. Okay, so here they are, out of Egypt, in the desert. What do they say? Why don't we go back to Egypt? Why didn't you leave us in Egypt? They go spy out the land. They come back and say, we can't take the land. There's giants. Two guys come and say, we can't take the land. We'll eat them for breakfast. So who entered? The two that said. What happened to 3 million that didn't say? They didn't enter. They didn't mix the promise with the confession of a good fight of faith. They didn't keep the good confession. Oh, we're going to the promised land. Where are you going? We're going to die in the desert. What did they do? They died in the desert. And Josh and Caleb, they took the land. Slew the giants. Oh, come on, man. They confessed we can do it, so we did it. Okay? So, where shall we pick it up? Verse 14. Inasmuch then as we have a great high priest who has already ascended and passed through the heavens, Jesus, Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. Again. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to understand. Now he said, here he will immediately come to us if we cry to him. Remember? Chapter 3. Now he says, we have one. He have a shared feeling with our weaknesses, came just like us, and our infirmities, and our liability to the assaults of temptation. But one who has been tempted in every respect as we are, yet without sinning. So let us then fearlessly, confidently, boldly, draw near to the throne of grace. What will we get there? Mercy. What will we find? Grace. For what? To help us in time of every need. Well-timed help coming just when we need. I don't know why God takes so long. I know you just said it. Verse 23. So let us seize. Let us hold fast and retain without wavering the hope we cherish and confess. What have you confessed already? Did you lay hold on it? Did you cling to it? Did you seize it? You know when something sees what happens to it? It doesn't move. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King. When an engine ceases, you can't turn the thing. What's wrong with your engine? It's seized. So he says, seize it. Hold fast to it. It can't get anywhere but stick to you. What? That which Christ has laid hold of you to give you everything he has and is, so that you can be exactly like him. He became exactly like you to make you exactly like him, and he perfected it on the cross and said, it's finished. Thank you. Confess. And our acknowledgement, again, our confession. For he who promised is reliable and faithful to his word. Verse 35. Do not therefore fling away your fearless confidence. For he carries a great, glorious compensation of reward. For you have need of steadfast patience and endurance, that you may perform and fully accomplish the will of God, and thus receive and carry away and enjoy to the full what is promised. Shout it, Alpha. Shout it out. Are you enjoying Christianity to the full? I'm not. There's stuff that I don't want. There's stuff that happens to me that I don't think is godly. There's stuff that happens to me that I don't see in Psalm 91. Remember early on I talked about the confession? Now I'm preaching. So if you listen to preaching, it says things that makes preaching preaching. So he says, if he says, you must receive, and after you receive it, carry it away. And after you carry it away, enjoy to the full everything that is promised.
Yeah. Amen.
Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall dwell on his holy hill? Pure hands, clean heart. He shall carry away. You never read Psalm 24, have you? He shall carry away the blessings of the Lord. So, where are you going? I'm just carrying. What are you carrying? Blessings. Enjoying to the full. Are you enjoying to the full? Or is there stuff that's not enjoyed to the full?
Yeah.
Kevin Prosh wrote the song nearly 14, 15 years ago. I know there is more. There's got to be more. So I'm asking for more. There must be more. There's got to be more. So I'm asking for more. There must be more. If Christianity is what we see in us, no wonder the world doesn't want to join us. Isn't it time that a Christian will rise that'll show Christ? With a full enjoyment of all the promises. Without laboring, getting because you believe. For you have need of steadfast patience to carry away that stuff. 37, here it comes. For still a little while, a very little while, and the coming one will come and he will not delay, but the just shall live by faith. And if he draws back, God says, I have no pleasure in him. But our way is not of those who draw back to eternal misery, but we are of those who believe, who cleave to and trust in and rely on God through Jesus Christ, and by faith preserve the soul. Now faith is the assurance, the confirmation, the title deed of the things we hope for being the proof of things that we do not see, the conviction of their reality, perceiving as a real fact what is not revealed to the senses. The faith of verse 1, we can put the context, we can preach anything on faith. Faith is what we live by. Okay? But the context in reality of the book of Hebrews is to make you exactly like Christ as a king and a ruler on this earth. Not in heaven, right here on this earth with heavenly power. Let your kingdom come and your will be done. This is a good confession, and Christ made that confession before Pilate. Now, dear church, are you ready to read with me the confession of Jesus Christ before Pilate? Now, this book that we read tonight said that is supposed to be your confession. 1 Timothy chapter 6 says, fight the good fight of faith. This good confession that you must keep on confessing. Christ made this good confession before Pilate. I'm just going to read it. Matthew 27 verse 11. Now Jesus stood before the governor Pilate, and the governor asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus said to him, you have stated the fact. Mark 15. Okay, can I read on? But when the charges were made against him by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him, do you not hear how many and how serious are the things that are testifying about you? But he made no reply to him, not even to a single accusation, so that the governor marveled greatly. Say, don't say. Oh, please. Yeah. Are you the king? He said, you stated the fact. He said, do you know what these people say about you? Do you know what they say about you? You know what they say about this church? You know what they say about this preacher? Are you a king? You stated the fact. Do you know what they say about you? Do you know what they... You know what the accusations is in the magazines and newspapers? Are you the king? You stated the fact. Do you know what they say about you? And the governor marveled. Let's go to Mark 15, 14. This is rough stuff. So you can see where we've missed that faith thing. Remember, 1 Timothy? Don't take that subtleties, that babblings. Don't speak it, because you miss your faith. Come on, me, you, I. Me, forget you, me. Mark 15, verse 2. And Pilate inquired of him, are you the king of the Jews? And he replied, it is as you say. And the chief priest kept accusing him of many things. And Pilate asked him again, have you no answer to make? See how many charges they are bringing against you. But Jesus made no further answer at all, so that Pilate wondered and marveled. Luke 23, verse 1, chapter 23. Then the whole assembly of them got up and conducted Jesus before Pilate, the Pontius one. And they began to accuse him, asserting, we found this man perverting, misleading, corrupting, and turning away our nation and forbidding to pay tribute to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One, a king. So Pilate asked him, are you the king of the Jews? And he answered him, it is just as you say, I am. John 18. So Pilate went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? They retorted, if he were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over to you. Pilate said to him, take him yourselves and judge and sentence him and punish him according to your law. The Jews answered, it is not lawful for us to put anyone to death. This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoke to show by what manner of death he was to die. So Pilate went back. Now this is where you've got to really listen tonight. So Pilate went back again to the judgment hall and called Jesus and asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Are you here? Jesus replied, Are you saying this of yourself on your own initiative, or have others told you about me? Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Your own people and nation and chief priests have delivered you to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, My kingdom belongs not to this world. If of this world, my followers would have been fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here, from this world. It has no such origin or source. Pilate said to him, Then you are a king. Jesus answered, You say it. You speak correctly. For I am a king. Certainly I am a king. This is why I was born. And for this I have come into the world. To bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth, who is a friend of the truth, who belongs to the truth, listens to my voice. So Romans 5:17, we rule in this life, in one Christ Jesus. So what is the good confession? I am a king.